Hello, my name is Dr. James Shamiyeh. I'm a pulmonary and critical care physician, and I'm also the Chief Quality Officer at the University of Tennessee Medical Center. As we've seen the COVID-19 pandemic accelerate, we thought it would be helpful for the people who watch this to have a sense of what's happening on the hospital side, and also just a good understanding about where we are in the pandemic and what's to come. Our thought, at least right now, is that we may try to share information like this in this forum about once a week, because knowing how things are progressing or potentially improving are going to be important as well. So I'm going to go through just a little bit of information about cases, hospitalizations, and really what we're seeing and what are the best ways to help things going forward. So here you see case counts across all of these counties. These are new cases by week. And what you see is in the December-January timeframe, we clearly had a lot of cases. Then over on the right-hand side, it had slowed down tremendously. And we've had this tremendous increase in cases just in the last few weeks. This looks like just a lot of lines, but we have learned that this group of southern states, Florida, Louisiana, Missouri, Tennessee, and Arkansas, have tended to track and follow each other throughout the pandemic. If you look at the far right-hand side, these are cases diagnosed in each of these states, and we're orange. Tennessee is clearly accelerating. Several of the other states started accelerating before we did. So we seem to be 3 to 4 weeks behind. Probably the states we're most like is Missouri and Arkansas. Missouri may be starting to plateau just a bit. Arkansas is still increasing. And so we're watching this very closely to try to predict what's to come. But the point being, all these states have very rapid rise in cases. This is the information that we get related to hospitalizations. This are the number of patients in the hospital on any given day across all of these counties. At the height of the pandemic previously, there were a total of 615 patients in the hospital. And then over on the right-hand side, you see that there are currently 302 patients in the hospital across all the hospitals in all these counties. What's very notable about this is the rate of rise of hospitalizations. And this is very similar to what we're being told and what we're observing in those other states that we're watching so closely. I think it's important to realize that even before this surge of COVID-19 patients in the hospital, our hospitals were quite busy taking care of patients with other diagnoses. And that's been true really ever since the last COVID-19 surge. So while the number of patients that are in the hospital right now with COVID-19 is not the same as it was when we were at our peak, the hospitals and the emergency departments are certainly busy taking care of patients with all kinds of diagnoses. So then some very specific information related to our hospital. First of all, just what are we seeing over the last 7 days and 30 days? So our COVID-19 census increase has increased by 33 in the last 7 days, and that's very significant, and by 65 in the last 30 days, and that's also very significant. The next thing we're seeing is the vast majority of patients who are in the hospital have not been fully vaccinated. And that's just very consistent with what you're hearing regionally and nationally, but that's also very much what we're seeing. And then in terms of the average age of the patients in the hospital, both in the acute care, which is not in the ICU, and in the intensive care unit, the average age is definitely lower than it was the last time. You see, those ages are all in the 50s. And so to have an average age in the 50s, that means you have some people that are in their 30s and 40s who are sick in the hospital. And this is very different than what we saw with the last wave, the Delta wave. This wave is behaving differently in terms of its speed and also in terms of who it is affecting. A few things, both from evidence, but also just what we are observing and seeing every day. The most common story of infection that we hear is it's transmitted between family, friends, and coworkers. We have to be careful in those environments. Another statistic is that if you have a group of 10 unvaccinated people get sick from COVID-19, the chance of at least one of those people being hospitalized due to COVID-19 is between 75 to 86%, so very significant. And we also hear stories about one family member being newly vaccinated seems to be very likely to influence another family member to be vaccinated. So then just a reminder about treatment. First of all, preventing hospitalization. That seems to be the number one key. As I've shown, vaccination is incredibly effective. Being careful is also potentially effective. Then if you're sick before hospitalization, there are monoclonal antibody injections or infusions. That is the type of situation where you need to discuss with your doctor whether that's right for you and to be referred. In the hospital, we do have medications to treat COVID-19. That has continued to evolve, and certainly, essentially, almost every patient who's in the hospital because of COVID-19 requires oxygen. And then the main thing that's used in the intensive care unit is a ventilator or a kind of a life support breathing machine. So another point that I want to make, it's important to understand that this increase in COVID-19 cases and hospitalizations is happening across the community. And so we have the same proportion of these patients that we've always had, and this same increase is happening to other hospitals in our region. So we know that emergency departments are going to be busy for the next several weeks. And one message that we want to send loud and clear, patients who need emergent care, we want those people to come to an emergency department, whether it's related to COVID-19 or related to any other illness. But I do think it's worth taking a moment just to emphasize there are other places to access care that may be more convenient for the patient. And we have 4 urgent cares regionally located. They provide excellent service. Certainly there are others in town as well. But we want to make sure, to the extent that's possible, patients who need to be in the emergency department are there, and the other patients who, quite frankly, will probably get quicker care if it's appropriate to be seen in an urgent care, go there. What are the types of things that are appropriate to go to an urgent care for versus what are the types of things that really need to be in the emergency department? But it just serves as a reference. If the situation is most appropriate for an emergency room, then that's where you need to be, and that's true whether we're in a pandemic or not. Remember that for some conditions, there are going to be other sites where you can access care. So now just a few closing thoughts. One question that we get asked quite frequently is whether the COVID-19 surge in hospital patients is going to affect our service offerings, specifically related to non-essential procedures. At this point, we anticipate that starting next week, selected non-essential procedures will need to be deferred. Certainly, those patients that affects are going to be individually contacted as those decisions are made, and we will be continually reassessing that to determine when we're able to go back to normal operations. I think the final point, and perhaps the most important, is that healthcare in general is interested in the safety and well-being of the population. And as much as we absolutely support vaccination, and we do, and I think the data that I showed related to hospitalizations really drives that home, that vaccination is highly effective at preventing people from ending up requiring hospitalization. I think what sometimes gets lost in that message is just we want people to be careful. We want as many people to avoid the negative effects of COVID-19 as possible. We want as many people to avoid being in the hospital as possible. And so in terms of those measures that we all know for several months, anything you can do to minimize your risk of COVID-19, whatever that means for you, is something we really think that people should try to do right now. This is very real. We're seeing real stories of patients having difficulty, and we just want to minimize that as much as possible. And so, as I said, we'll try to keep you informed to the extent that we can, and I appreciate your time in watching this video.